Don't forget that part.
I do a webcomic called The Extras, which we also have in print form here.
Oh, I've seen that somewhere before. Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys, if anyone wants to check out online, grab a card.
All right, and working camera, at least for the writing portion, is Mark Dudley, one of our resident artists and art director for Shining Otaku.
The old man at the old hill.
All right. You can also say he's the godfather of the whole operation.
Oh, one
thing. Oh, yeah, you can't say that. Don't say that.
Yeah, does not want us to say that. So right. We're going to move forward. So, yeah. Thank y'all very much for joining us. Now, without further ado, I guess that we can go ahead and get started.
Yes, we can have the awesome intro here.
Oh, yeah, we have an intro showing y'all some of our stuff. What you're going to be seeing is some of our various projects. That's from a comic that we did for Palladium Books. Those of you that might know it as Riffs, Nightbane. They're also doing a Kickstarter for the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles RPG. So you can see that. It's a very cool series. Honestly, hoping to get back to work on it at some point.
We will.
Oh, yeah. That's actually that's the logo for my series, Paragon Panic. That's a superhero comedy, centering on the main character, Panda Man. You'll be able to see that one, I believe, starting next year. Thank you. And here's some work for Judafist, Seven Deaths of the Yobi, Mark Dudley's brainchild. So, the reason why we're showing a lot of this off is to give y'all an example of what we bring to the table, and to show y'all what you can learn from us. And of course, there's Brianna's Project Nirvana. There he is. You're gonna be seeing that one in our next collection, Imaginos Plus. Four.
Oh no, that's gonna be in Origami Super Punch.
Oh, that's right, Origami Super Punch from Shiny Otaku.
And that's Naraku Murder, probably one of the longest stories that we did, you know, by another creator who's not here right at the moment, named Techie. And there's Killbox. That's mine. It's a hip hop battle manga. So if you guys like that.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. So now that we've gotten that out of the way, we can go ahead and get started here. Now
I'll show you guys we were legit.
Oh yeah. Well, while Jeff sets that up, quick show of hands. How many of you all are already making your own comics and manga? Okay, we have one, two. Oh, come on, don't wave. Go on, yes or no? Come on. There we go, come on, all right. Okay, so we got four creators here, all right, great. Now, quick question. For those that did not raise their hand, what do you think is stopping you from making your own comics and manga?
Yourself!
What now?
Exactly. You are your most prominent stumbling block. So,
there's skills that you can learn, so.
Practice is how you get to Carnegie Hall, and that's how you get printed on the page.
That's right.
Good old.
So we'll go ahead and get going. Now, first thing and foremost, who are we to be talking about this stuff? Well, we're Imaginals Workshop. We are a Michigan-based create idea generator, is what we like to call ourselves.
Production company.
We generate intellectual property on various mediums. We have comics. We actually write and direct and produce short films. We have a podcast, which I'm actually the host of, which is why I got stuck doing this. And also, of course, independent comics. And through Shining Otaku, we also do manga. We have some partnerships with local comic shops, as well as Lake Orion Public Access. That's where a lot of our material gets aired. And and also Open University for any OU graduates out there. Now, Now the slide says plenty right there, but can anyone actually tell me what the difference is between independent comics and mainstream comics? All right. Speak your truth, brother.
Okay, so yeah. Marvel and DC, they have and had, still sometimes have good stories, but as of recent, with too many politics into it, it's oversaturated the market. Mm. Also, the storylines are very inconsistent because there's so many writers and different artists on it. Whereas, let's talk about something really good, that's indie girl, Invincible. We have one storyline, it's beginning, middle, and end. Perfect overarching plot that's written by three dudes, not a million other ones. And that's an Image property, even though it's so big, that started out as a small thing.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Plenty of editorial in there, but you know what? I can't argue with you. Yes, mainstream comics, for the most part, do have a stranglehold. Now, mainstream, Marvel, DC, some might argue Image falls into that because of their size now, but because of their emphasis on creator-owned content, they still technically qualify as indies. Now, in terms of indie comics not listed on that slide, can anyone name any others for me?
Images?
Huh?
Image comic?
Image comic? Well, any titles?
Saga.
Like
Oh, Saga. Great one.
Invincible?
Invincible, yeah. Mentioned in Invincible.
Spawn.
Yep, Spawn. Okay.
The Boys.
Oh, The Boys qualifies.
It's only like one volume, but I've read one called Punk Rock Jesus.
Punk Rock Jesus, absolutely. Yes.
I hate Fairy Dance. I hate Fairy Dance.
Oh, I hate Fairy Dance. Yeah, that's a good one too. Now, and not only is this meant to gauge the audience, but this is also to shout out some recommendations for y'all to check out at your local comic book. Now, when it comes down to it, though, yes, what Brother Man said over there, what was your name, man?
Jay.
What Jay said earlier is absolutely correct. Most independent comics can be gauged a lot like, well, up until the cinematic universe boom, a standard film that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. So, in terms of independent, if you don't have an ongoing story in mind, you're basically, you've got your story. It's important to know your story before you keep going. Now, on the next one?
Next one.
Oh, yeah. Now, for the manga portion, I'm going to go to our resident manga creators to discuss what OEL actually represents.
Okay, so this is a complicated topic because there's a lot of research behind it. But original English language manga, in short, usually is considered to be manga that's generated by people who were originally in the English language. So for example, you know, many of us, you know, English is our native tongue, and because it is, you know, any manga that we make, people debate whether or not if it's manga or if it's not manga. I'm not sure how many of you out there kind of heard that debate. Like, for example, even though this isn't manga, people debate about Avatar the Last Airbender. Is it anime? Is it not anime? That's like a constant debate, you know. People say, well, it is anime because it has the stylings of anime, but then you really have to get into the crux of, well, what actually makes anime what it is, and the same thing with manga, going back to manga, which is what the topic is about, what makes manga what it actually is? Is it the cultural aspects of Japanese culture, which, you know, makes manga what it is, or are we as people who are, you know, many of us who are, you know, maybe that may not be our culture, being Japanese or anything like that, can you actually create manga, or is it just a comic? What makes the stylings of that? So a lot of people have termed it to be, you know, original English language manga. That originally, I think, kind of came, or it didn't come around with Tokyo Pop, but the term kind of, with a lot of properties that Tokyo Pop released, I think in the early 2000s, that term was kind of invented for the stylings of manga projects like that. So Scott Pilgrim, for example, what would a lot of you guys consider Scott Pilgrim to be? Anybody out there?
That's an indie comic.
So there are people who would say it's an indie comic. The creator of the, I can't think of his name.
Brian O'Malley.
Yeah, Brian O'Malley has considered to be manga inspired, but he doesn't call it OEL. You see what I'm saying? It depends on, like, some people, if you ask them that, or there's other books out there where some people may say, well, for example, like Bree's Project Nirvana, some people may consider it to be just a comic, some people may consider it to be more manga inspired. We just usually use the term, you know, more loosely with, you know, OEL, just so that we are not appropriating the culture.
Right. And like the extras, you know, it's like you know, manga is definitely an inspiration, but I don't consider it to be manga. It's an indie comic, but it has inspiration, and there's a lot of, you know, stuff that goes into it. So, but yeah, but it's always an interesting debate. Like, where do you draw the line, and what is the what percentage do you assign a percentage to it? Is it, you know, how do you do it?
Exactly.
Yeah,
so that's the interesting thing about it. That's the reason why we kind of use that term more to describe what we do, because the works that we do, we try to write from our own experiences and, you know, what we go through, and not just do a carbon copy of Bleach 2.0, or, you know, I guess nowadays it would probably be like doing like a new version of My Hero Academia or whatever. I know a lot of times when I mention Bleach to like kids now, they're like, what, Bleach? So I'm like, dang.
I think Black Clover qualifies as the new Bleach.
Yeah, Black Clover or Demon Slayer or something. So I'm like, I have to think of all the new stuff.
Jujutsu.
Yeah, Jujutsu. Oh, there we go. There we go. Jujutsu Kaisen is probably the new Bleach. I don't know.
All right. Now, for this first portion, we're going to be talking about writing. Art has its own section a little bit later, which I know Mark Dudley is very excited to get started on, but we're going to start with the writing portion. Now, clearly, according to the slide, story is everything. Now, would you say that in terms of, how many of you believe that the art is more important than the writing in terms of manga and comics? No judgment? Feel free? Okay. Yep. Appreciate your honesty. Oh, okay.
Okay,
we got more than one. Okay.
A couple of the majorities.
All right. Now, here is something that you would probably hear a lot. A writer is going to say that the writing is the most important. An artist is going to say that the art is the most important. We believe they need to work in concert. Because the fact of the matter is, good art doesn't always save a bad story, but good writing can't always save bad art. If the creation is unbalanced, unfortunately, that just puts too much attention on one side. That just messes up the entire equilibrium. So, both are very, very important. Now, in terms of stories, there's a few different types. Like here, labeled from Robert McKee. How many people can tell me what an arc plot is? Okay. Jay, we're going to give you a little bit of a break there. Bro, what you got for me?
Basically, character development. So, I guess from one way that you're growing to another place.
Okay, so to summarize, it's a, you'd say it's a character development-based story. Okay.
An arc would basically be any kind of like plot line extends more than just beyond like one issue or chapter. That's kind of how I viewed it, and then it ends kind of conclusively with all that in mind. And that can, like you said, be character arcs or what have you, or plot arcs.
Okay. All right. Neither is particularly wrong, but parts of the whole.
I always considered it to be like a self-contained story within an ongoing series.
Okay, okay.
It has a beginning, middle, end, but the series still continues.
Okay, okay. All right, thank you very much for everyone contributing. None of those answers were wrong. You are all correct to one extent or another. Now, the arc plot itself, it is specifically character-focused, but arcs refer to multiple different things, each of those things being very much correct. It's all about context. But in this particular context, an arc plot does actually specifically center on the arc of the primary characters, or main character, or supporting cast. Jeff, you want to say something?
Nope, I'm just not in agreement.
Okay. Now, what about anti-plot?
That's a little, probably a simpler way to talk about arc plot.
Oh, okay, okay.
Think of arc plot. Great, mark that quick. So, the thing with arc plot, and you have to talk about these three things together. Arc plot is the plot that you know about, usually like with Star Wars, or with Zorro, or whatever like that, right? The arc, so basically you got it's a three-act structure, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So you got your intro, then you got the intro which shows the problem, then you got the problem that they have to overcome, and then you have the
climax.
Yeah, the climax, right? The resolution. So
yeah.
That's your basic arc plot, right? Mm-hmm. Then you got this anti-plot.
Mm-hmm.
Anti-plot, how many of you guys have seen Monty Python, Holy Grail? The thing with, anti-plot is there's ridiculous stuff that happens in anti-plot, right? So basically you could be riding a horse and next thing you know a Volkswagen drops out of the air. Okay? Those type of stories are anti-plot. And then you have meta-plot, which all takes place in the character's head. Really nothing happens to the character in the physical world. The whole plot takes place in the actual head of the character.
It's like an imagination thought process.
Second part?
Thinking process.
Well, yeah, it's like, okay, let's say like, yeah.
Never-ending story is one. What's the... Labyrinth technically could...
Well, then it's sort of crazy because you got, Being John Malkovich?
Being John Malkovich. Okay.
Right, that's...
What was that one Zack Snyder film called?
Sucker Punch.
Sucker Punch. Sucker Punch is a prime example.
You know, it might be, maybe.
That is a deeper conversation that we have time for tonight. So those are some examples of meta plots in that regard.
And you can mix these things together when writing, when you're plotting.
Yeah, absolutely. Any type of plot you want to tell can mix all of those elements. And as long as your story is coherent enough for the audience to follow. Now, of course, there was the discussion of character arcs that was brought up earlier, and those are obviously very important as well. Your redemption arc, damnation arc, flat arc. Now, obviously, redemption and damnation, those are pretty explanatory. Who can tell me what a flat arc is? Okay. Oh, go ahead, Andrew.
I don't know, but I'd like to take a crack at it. Is it like
hey, go for it.
Would that be more like the slice of life animes you see, where it's just like nothing, like it doesn't really change. Like you're just seeing these people's life, kind of like cinema of their thing.
Interesting interpretation.
The thing is with those, the three of those is this, right? It all comes down to the character's relationship to the truth.
Mm.
Okay? So with that, let's start with the arc, with the redemption arc, we know what this is. You know, we've seen it a thousand times. People don't believe the truth at first, and then throughout the arc, they learn the truth.
Or, for another example, Goku. Goku is an example of a flat iron. He changes the world around him, he doesn't necessarily change himself. Yeah. And no training
question
to get stronger technically doesn't start.
Question
go on ahead.
What the truth of lot, or the, what is it, the...
I said they believe the truth by
what
first.
What is that movie, the invention of lying?
The invention of lying?
Because he knows he can lie, but nobody else.
So he knows the truth, right?
Right.
And he's affecting stuff around.
He can lie to anybody, but they can't lie to him.
Right, right.
Oh, that could definitely qualify.
Unfortunately,
I'm not sure I haven't seen that one, so I wouldn't be able to say for sure.
Yeah, that's definitely flat out. Yeah.
Oh, it is? Okay. Okay. So, yeah. That's an example of a flat.
Now, mind you, these are all tools if you for you writers. These are all tools that you guys want to use when you're thinking about creating these stories.
Right, they're guidelines. So, they are rules, but they are also guides for you to exercise your vision. These are just tools that you can use.
Right.
Go on, next one.
That's true.
All right. Now, in terms of the structure of stories. Now, clearly we've seen all different kinds of story structures at work here. Now, basically the core purpose of the story structure is to give your story impact, purpose, or gravitas. Now, to do that, it's basically to elicit things that make either your protagonist relatable or to issue to place a situation in which you can sympathize, empathize, or even get enraged by the character. You relate to them to some way. Doesn't always have to be positive, doesn't always have to be negative, but you should feel something for that character during the course of that story.
And absolutely, nothing is as boring as a perfect character living in a perfect world who the character's your baby and you're afraid to hurt them.
The Mary Sue dilemma as part.
Yes, that's the worst, so don't do that.
Yeah.
That's why that wound, tragic, flawed relationship is important.
Absolutely.
All right, the wound is something that happened to that character before you even step onto that page.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Let's say that the character has trouble.
Harry Potter.
Yeah, Harry Potter. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Yeah. The character has had some horrible thing in their past.
Yeah, some horrible thing in their past, and what that's going to do, that's going to inform their tragic flaw throughout the story.
Mm-hmm. Or has any of you seen the movie Memento by Christopher Nolan?
I've seen the Indian version.
That might even yield a whole different perspective. But that is actually a prime example, because the entire story is what happened to set this guy on this path. And though Nolan uses an unconventional structure to convey that story, there is a structure there meant to elicit his thoughts and thinking there. Now,
hey, Brianna, what was the wound in Project Nirvana?
So in Project Nirvana, my main friend Hiroi, she goes through a lot of stuff, but her main wound is that she basically was manipulated by a guy to like not trust people, so she's been isolated from people because she believes that this guy who says like don't trust people. So her flaw is that she bottles stuff up, she keeps to herself, she puts this like persona on that she hates the world and she doesn't want to be associated with people. And then she slowly like opens up and realizes that people don't suck, so you know, I can give people a chance. I can open up or I can be more of myself.
Right.
And as stated on the slide, stories do have the two trends, the physical and the emotional. Physical is what is actually happening. The emotional, of course, is what's happening to the character or characters.
Right. But the only thing, too, that wound we talked about, look at that wound, there's a big deep hole, and that other train is trying to fill that hole. Mm. By the end of the whatever it is, the movie or whatever, the end of the comic, you want to fill the plot hole and you want to fill the emotional hole.
Whether it's a one-shot or a series that you're trying to make, that is the ongoing goal. Now, And obviously, moving on to the serialized arena of story, there's the series trigger, and then there's the pilot trigger. Now, clearly, it's written, series trigger happens to the character. Meaning, these are circumstances that the character does not necessarily have control over, gets the entire story in motion.
Yeah, like a big boulder falling on somebody.
Mm-hmm. Yes. But the pilot trigger, which always has to happen in the first issue, first chapter, first act, is what the character does about it. That has to be in the beginning, because that's your story leaving the station.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Technically, you are correct. The series trigger is when Shanks gives Luffy the hat. The pilot trigger is Luffy winding up on the boat that he meets Kobe.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That would technically count as the pilot trigger.
Wouldn't the series trigger one piece technically be when Gold Rush is killed?
Mmm. Mm.
Now that actually
is a really good question, but in terms of the series trigger, I think it would still technically focus on what happens to the main character. Now, that could definitely be a major event in the world if you do not have a centralized character established yet, but honestly, yeah, that could still work as well. Yeah, we're trying to do flex.
Having more than one isn't necessarily bad.
Oh, absolutely not. Oh, no. If you want to have a living, breathing world, there's absolutely going to be stuff that's going to put things in motion.
That series trigger, again, see, this is the thing, there's a concept called the marquee character, the person who's in the front on the billboard.
Mm.
And I don't care if you've got an ensemble cast, somebody's going to be on the front of that billboard, okay? Mm. So the series trigger usually happens to that character.
Yeah, so it still is character focused, but there could be things that serve as linchpins to your world building that can still function that as well. Jeff, next one.
What's the last one?
Well, that also ties into that's the structure, but that's also the character progression aspect.
So that's to overcome things, like Jeff said. You got to put them in some type of peril, some type of jeopardy.
All right. Okay. Now, among the creators here, how many of y'all actually like writing dialogue? Thank you for there being an issue, too. Thank you.
For me, I'm with that.
All right. Now, and here's that's the thing. Dialogue gives information that cannot always be conveyed as easily in sequential art. That's why you'll often see people that unfortunately don't know how to structure their panels put massive word balloons across a stagnant page. It's
or worse yet, you begin your story with 4 pages of back history and story and exposition about the
Yes.
The Zarfian Empire, when nobody knows what the Zarfian Empire is or why we should care yet.
If you want to...
Don't do that.
Backstory and lore are important, but if you want your story to be engaging, pepper it into the story itself.
Put it this way. If you want to show the history of the Zarfian Empire, then you take your main character, and through what the main character does and the challenges that they face and things that happen to them, you can show us instead of telling us. Show us what the Empire is like and why it's good or bad or what the problem is.
Mm. Hey, Arthur, how many words in word balloon?
25.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. Oh, go ahead.
I've always had trouble with inner monologues, like inner dialogue. Could be something that can add to the story, but it also can be like the character explaining something that we already see on the screen.
I personally never use inner monologue at all. I mean, of course, that's going to depend on your own personal. personal effects and style, but it could be an important part of it. But I guess the first thing to ask is it really necessary? Can you just show it?
Yeah. Is there a way to show it rather than tell it?
Oh,
yeah, the serial killer show?
Yeah, he talks in his head all the time. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's more interesting because he was a serial killer. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to know what's going on through his mind, so I guess that could be something. Mm-hmm. The Promised Neverland in the manga, he does a lot too.
Okay.
They do like strategizing and things about like what they're going to do next and all that, so that could be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a manga called Blue Period about art. Mm-hmm. And in that one, he's thinking about his own anxieties.
Okay.
So I guess in those three examples,
I think you can pull that off, but you can't have the character actually doing what you said they were going to do. Because you either going to be show or tell. Those are the only two things you're
going to
get.
If you do both at the same time, unfortunately, you're going to slow down the pace of your own story. So the goal is to figure out which one serves your story better. Would an inner monologue work best for kind of explaining what the main character is doing? Or would it just be best to panel it out, what they're doing?
The very last thing you want is you have a panel of a character falling off a log, and there's a dialogue balloon with the character saying, oh no, I'm falling off a log. And there's a narration log saying, and then you fell off the log.
But that's funny. You made that really funny.
Or to take an example from the Golden Age of comic Sounds, I've lost my... Yes.
But if you're doing it for a reason for comedy, then yeah, you probably get away with that.
Yeah, well, that's
comedy.
Yeah.
The psychological definitely would warrant inner monologue, but what's more, it also really depends on the type of story you're telling. That can actually, especially in a psychological-based story or thriller, that can add tension, especially if the inner monologue is, should I kill this person now because they're about to find out something, or am I going to give something away that's going to put me in danger? It all boils down to the purpose of it.
It's funny you say that because Death Note is one of my favorite manga, and that's literally
The potato chip. Yeah, the potato chips in
eat.
Yeah. Like that's actually a really firm example of basically they're illustrating he's illustrating his plan, but he's doing it through his inner monologue. Like anyone ever seen the Ocean's 11 movies? No, that series? You know how they basically do the heist while explaining how they're going to do the heist?
Yeah.
That's basically story that's story efficiency, effectively. Like, you don't do that unless it's actually going to go exactly how they're explaining it. If something's going to go wrong, then you start deviating.
But since you got, you're working in comics, so you have, it's a visual medium, so you can show the audience what's happening. So, limit your dialogue and everything else to, things that we don't see in the art.
Got a quick question.
Things that build the character.
Got a quick question. Who just walked in here? Two guys?
Oh.
Because I got a raffle ticket for you.
Any new entry?
Did anyone just walk in?
I thought somebody just walked. That's okay. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Oh, man, I just forgot.
Sorry, man.
We got some time, so we
got
think
time,
about it.
So we'll get back to it when you remember.
Yeah, right there.
This card's right over at that table. We have a website. We post our podcast there, future events and things like that.
Y'all want to say something right quick before he leaves? And this is the thing. We're doing this because back in the day, I might say this to some of you guys out before, right? Back in the day, this community used to be kind of tight, okay? Everybody knew each other. Everybody helped each other out. We're trying to foster that again.
Mm-hmm.
So... By the time this is over, please take the business cards and whatever. If you guys got any questions, get in touch with us.
Hit us up on our website or our Facebook page. So
check us out on YouTube. Shining Spotlight.
Yeah, we got all that in the.
Oh, yeah. Now, in terms of dialogue.
Take some swag too while you're at it.
Oh, yeah, we got posters for our different projects. Feel free to take any of that. Now, in terms of dialogue, though, unique voice is important. If you're going to have multiple characters on a page, you you should be able to tell through their dialogue different people are talking. It is paramount. Now that's not easy. You're going to it's going to take work to figure all that out.
Okay, so on that, I agree that is really hard. But one thing I've found that helps is you take speech patterns of like your friends or people you know or people in certain areas. You can kind of
absolutely. You should be drawing from your personal experiences in regards to your writing. That helps you give your characters individual voices.
So like if you know someone who's like kind of southern, you can kind of put that for someone who's southern as a character, I guess.
Hard to articulate on the written page, but once you create the codex for it, it gives you so much more flavor in your stories. So something to consider in that regard. You don't want a Tarantino in either. Not everybody should be a wicked quickster. We live in the real world. Not everybody's that weird. That's another important aspect of differentiating
Nick
your characters. There are people that have stilted speech patterns. There are people that over-explain. There are people that are very, very slang-oriented in their speech. That should all be referenced in your dialogue.
Yep. And, dialects, accents, all that
stuff. Absolutely. Next slide.
That's the last slide, yeah.
Okay.
That's the last slide for that part, yes.
Yeah, for the writer's portion. Now, before we move into the art, does anyone have any questions or anything that they want to ask about from a writing standpoint before we move over to that excitable individual?
Actually, we're going to do a little raffle before we move over there.
Oh, we're going to do a raffle first?
A couple things.
Okay, well, any questions?
I'm just speaking for myself. Whenever I have to make my plot or whatever, I have to basically just shop it around to like my one or two friends I guess I trust.
Okay.
And get their feedback. So whenever you guys do it, like in that group, how does that work? Like whenever you review stuff?
Oh yeah, we always talk to each other in regards to that. Now,
we fight sometimes too.
Everyone blames me. They think I'm a horrible individual.
He has a nickname. What's that nickname?
No,
we're calling Machete Jeff. Machete Jeff, that's what we call him.
It is very important that you have somebody you trust to read over your stuff. Even if it's just as like, hey, can you spell check this for me? Because at bare minimum, you want to make sure you are putting out the best quality product.
Meaning, can you spell check that for Mark Dutton?
You want someone who can give you honest feedback, too. Maybe knows something about story and writing, and also someone who's not going to say, oh, it's so, you're my friend, it's so good. No, just
can I give you a hug?
Find someone who can be vicious.
If you're writing romance novels, do not go to the science fiction writer.
Right.
Make sure that whoever you get to read your stuff has a firm grasp and understanding of the genre you're working in as well.
And you gotta have, look, I'll be honest with you, this is the key thing. You gotta have a thick skin, man. This is not a pursuit for the weak, mind.
This is a labor. Comics and manga are a labor of love. You can ask any mangaka. They slave for their work because they love doing it. But they also, for every project they get in the Shonen Jump or that gets made at Marvel, they have done 15, 16 others that never even made it past the pitching stage. Not every idea is right for at that moment. But that does not mean that parts of that idea aren't going to live on in a later project.
Brianna, how much did we go over your dialogue and talk?
It was a process. I'm not going to lie.
I went through 5 drafts of my first comic before it was ready to go into our first anthology.
He was the first one that got the red pen ever.
I haven't seen so much red ink since I was in high school.
Yeah, and I think your question was more like, what's the process like? Well, we send it around in the group chat, and we pick it up one by one and read through it, and everyone puts their notes in, and then I get it, and Joe, your the first script you gave me, I think it was way more red ink than there were actual words.
That's true.
The one you sent me last time, I had almost nothing to say about it because it was so good. So,
absolutely. Yeah. There are lessons to be learned.
Yes.
And that's why it's also important. If you are someone blessed enough to have a crew or a group that you work with,
then
it is absolutely imperative to let them in on your process. Let them in on what you're working on.
Let me segue that right quick.
Oh.
The thing is, we encourage you guys to form groups.
Mm-hmm.
Get each other information if you can before you leave here. Form groups. Do things. And we always are here to help you guys out.
And also learn together. Everybody learn the same things there, so they can all give each other, you know, feedback that is actually, you know, means something.
Does that mean we can shamelessly self-promote?
Absolutely. Well, so, yeah. I mean, heck, there's going to be a portfolio gauging out.
That's
kind of
why we made this panel.
Oh, yeah.
One more thing. Mm-hmm. I have an insidious purpose for this whole thing.
Yeah.
All right. So, we will eventually do an annual manga project called Perfect Killing. And so, any of you guys who were going to take a tumble at it, you guys gonna have our information. Send us your book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, and so then, from a group standpoint, yes. No. If you're blessed enough to have people that you trust to share your work with, do so, because you will only be able to get better. Do not perfection. Assuming your stuff is good as is the enemy of your progress.
Yeah.
Assume that you have work you need to do. Because then you're just going to get that much more out of yourself. Now, I'm going to stop yapping, and we're going to pull some tickets. All right. What's the first ticket?
Consideration for creating want each one of your pages to have. You want to have an establishing shot that tells you where and when, okay? In other words, you people hate backgrounds, that's what that is, background. Okay? And look, you can steal background, you can draw background, whatever you want to do, just put some backgrounds in there. Okay? At least in that establishing shot.
Or like the artist from Full Metal Alchemist, she didn't do backgrounds hardly ever.
Yeah, she's kicking the butt. Anyway. Focuses on the main subject of the page. You can have more than one mid shot. There's a mid shot, and there's a mid shot. All right? And finally, you need a close up. This is a montage from when he was remembering something, so I make this character the main, the close up in the on this page, because he's remembering all of this stuff.
This is also from the first issue of Judafist, Seven Deaths of the Yomi, on sale now.
And webcomic. Yeah, this is important though. Really, these three shots have to be there. You can have multiple of that shot. Be careful having multiple of the other two. I say you can't, but you want to be careful. Okay? That make any sense? Alright, next slide, please. Okay, now, rhythm. Now this is mechanical and technical. Alright? Rhythm equals drama over time and panel size. What is the defining thing about comics? I kind of ask people all the time, right? The thing with comics, you can play with time. Okay? If you want somebody to pay more attention, if you got something going on, you want people to look at, and it's taking up more time, you make the panel bigger. But you also have to think about drama as it relates to that, right? So I did a graph here. Drama. Over time, fast panel size, okay? Panel one, that's gonna be an establishing shot, right? You get to see everybody involved in this particular scene, right? Not gonna be that much drama. Panel two, huge, okay? It's mad dramatic, you know? You get to see the angst of this character, you know, this character is plotting something or this character is hiding something. It's a lot of drama, so as you can see, boom! That moves up to the top of the of the time panel drama graph. Panel three, it's an inlet panel, but it still has a lot of drama because it's a close-up, right? Or really a big shot because you see the people in the background. You know it goes down a little bit dramatically, but having said that, it's still not going down to the level of one or two. Panel. Four. This starts to kind of look at the bloody hand now. There's a lot of drama there, okay? So the drama rises up a little bit more. And then finally, you see the blood dropping on the foot, which is going to be panel five. The drama drops, but it doesn't drop back to the level of the original two panels. Does that make any sense? This is what you think about when you are looking at panel rhythm. Okay, you gotta look at the amount of drama happening in that panel, which you're gonna see when you're writing the script. Okay, now mind you, I didn't really talk about this before. You got two types of scripts, at least here in the West. You have what we call a DC script, and you have what we call a Marvel script. Marvel script is basically an outline that the person goes back and they put the dialogue in. Okay, DC script is a full script.
Now, this particular bit about rhythm is applicable for both writers and artists.
Yep.
This would be present in both the script as well as the outlining of the page art.
And this is why writing and art is a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yep. No one should dominate the other.
This is a crazy topic. Are there any questions? Mm-hmm. This is a lot right here. So are there any questions on this? So you guys are all picking it up when I'm laying down, as they say.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
One thing that also to mention, the final panel of the page, whether it's the first page or the last page, it should always be a cliffhanger.
To make you go to the next page. Thank you, sir.
You want your audience to want to keep reading. So it's not like not quite like a novel. A novel is going to have a different rhythm and pacing. On a comic or a manga, every good one makes you want to turn
Am I moving
page.
Too fast?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And when you
reach into the sequence, you can have the punchline.
If you're doing comedy.
All right, that's last. Ah, balance. That's right. This is the that man back there is doing. That's his manga. Siege.
Nick Amati.
Right. He thought I wasn't going to use it. That's right.
I mean.
What this we're talking about here is balance, and this is an actual art. Balance is important as it relates to your page because you don't want to overwhelm the reader's eye. If you got too much going on in a panel, then that eye is gonna, or from even on the page, that eye is gonna just go crazy. Okay, you want to give the eye someplace to rest. So here with Massacre, Rat Bastard, that guy. Massacre got a lot of blacks in, right? A lot of blacks in the whole panel, right? So we got two people looking at Massacre. That's why we use whites right here, right? Because it gives your eye a place to rest in this panel, okay? It's not so busy, it's not, you don't have your head going, oh, what the hell is that, right? Now, Siege, again, since Massacre, since we have a lot of blacks here with Siege, but not as many blacks as here with Massacre, we don't need as much white space for your eye rest.
Mark, for context, would this be applicable also for a splash page?
Yep, exactly, it sure would. Okay. Look at the splash page, it just matters.
Mm-hmm.
All right. You guys, so, all right, that got concept okay, you guys? Or I'm going to make sure I'm explaining it right.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so, next slide, please. Ah, that's right. Perfect. But I'm going to tell you why you do it. I'm not going to sit up here and be like, ah, perfection, I'm going to tell you why you do it. All right, 1 point perspective. 1 point perspective has one vanishing point and a horizon line. That's the vanishing point, that's the horizon line. Okay? Now, 1 point perspective is used to convey the distances between the foreground, the midground, and the background. That's what 1 point perspective is there. So let's say you got a guy in the foreground, then you want to see how he looks relative to the guy in the midground, and then the guy in the background. Okay? That make any sense? Let me know, I can stop. Okay? Now, that's 1 point perspective. That's what it's used for. 2 point perspective has one horizon line, but it has two vanishing points. And the thing with 2 point is that you always want to draw the vanishing point outside of the camera view. See that square? That's the camera view. You always want to draw the vanishing point outside of the camera view, okay? So, what 2 point is used for is for pan. You guys know when we got a camera, you know this, Jay knows this. The pan goes from left to right or from right to left, okay? 2 point is made to mimic that across the screen, but it also conveys the vastness of the background with respect to the characters or objects in it. So 2 point still has some elements of 1 point. Two. All right? So
another way, panoramic shot.
Right, panoramic shot. That's another way of putting it. Right? Mm-hmm. 3 point has an horizon line. It has 2 points, just like the 2 point where you do it outside of or outside of the camera or aperture. Then you can put another point above or below the horizon, right? What that does for you, it depends on where you put the third vanishing point. If you put the third vanishing point above, what it does, it kind of portrays stature. So let's say you got Superman standing right here, right? You shooting him. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was going to say, once you're done going through these points, are you going to show us some, I guess, picture examples of these points of perspective?
You know what? I was in such a rush, I didn't have it.
All you need but, is
box? Yeah, I mean, this is my last slide, I'm sorry. But you guys have probably seen that thing where Superman is, so here's the roof right here, right? Camera's down here, Superman standing like this, right? Cape waving, whatever, but you're looking at Superman from below Superman, right? That's 3 point where the vanishing point is below the horizon line. Now,
statuesque shot.
Right. Now you've also probably seen Superman flying, and the buildings are down there, right? Yeah. That's when the vanishing point So, again, these are the shots when you guys are drawing your things, your pages. These are the uses of these particular perspectives in terms of your shot choice. That make any sense? Okay, the 180 rule. Oh, Jay's like, you know, 180. So, the 180 rule, it applies in comics and manga just like it does in Jay doing film stuff. Alright, the thing is, you can create a panel from anything within the 180 degree view in front of the camera. That's the camera. Anything within this view here, 180, the camera's pointing this way, you guys can take that shot, okay? Anything not in that view cannot be put in the panel, i.e., not in the 180 view or behind the camera. Here the camera, you see in front of the camera, you see behind the camera. You can't show any of that, you know, when the camera's pointing the opposite direction. Oh, but there's that. If you want to put something behind the camera, you have to turn the camera completely around. But you just can't do that, right, Jay? You have to do a transitional shot. So, no, you need to create a shot within the initial 180. So let's say this is the 180. You have to create a shot right here, you can do it here, you can do it here. But I have to transition to you turning this camera completely around. That way it does, it's not jarring. You don't want it to be jarring. That make any sense? Well, you could do, or basically it's like this, right? Let's say the character was here. If the character was here, and you want to turn the panel around, you could actually, the camera pointed this way, you could actually go ahead and turn the camera around from that, because it's not 180. It all has to be 180. If you're going to, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. As an example of breaking the 180 rule, like when two characters suddenly swap positions when they're talking.
Yeah, and you have no transition.
Yep.
panel consistency, and you do not ever want to break that.
That make any sense? What I was saying? Okay. All right, so the 180 rule, again, I just tried to go through these things and explain these things to you guys as quickly and logically as possible, because a lot of times when you guys are going through this drawing stuff, no one's going to take this. Yeah, they're just going to be like, oh, believe in yourself, yeah! I don't work like that, you know. I'm going to give a person a fish, they'll eat. But he said, give a person a fish, they'll eat for a day. Teach them how to fish, they'll eat forever. I'm going to teach you how to fish. All right? So, let's hit the next group. This is just tools and stuff you got here. That's nothing big. So, this stuff right here is key stuff. That's why I want to make sure you guys saw. Okay? And you look at it in conjunction with what Joe and Jeff are talking. So,
yeah, we didn't pay for the internet, y'all.
All right, creative comics, tools of the trade. A lot of you guys know the genius stuff, so. Okay, Jeff, hit that now. Ah, physical tools, right? Non-photo blue pencil. Anybody use it? Anybody ever used it? Non-photo blue pencil is cool. It's just a blue pencil, and you know what it does. It makes it.
Oh, you've used blue pencil before?
Who used the non-photo blue?
All right. Oh, all right. She uses blue pencil.
Blue pencil is great because it doesn't show up on copiers. Non-photo red doesn't either. Yeah. So, the non-photo blue pencils are used a lot in the comic industry and the manga industry, right? So, automatic pencil lead I use automatic pencils. They come in different lead sizes. And the thing is, I didn't talk about this in the drawing part, but I will. Line thicknesses. The difference between manga and comics is a line thickness thing. Comics are more focused on shape length, right? The shape of things. Manga is more focused on line, the size of the line. But when you're inking, you still use that in Western comics too. Right. So when you use these different size lead, like let's say you use a 8 lead or whatever, that's usually for something in the foreground. You use a 5, something for usually or something in the mid ground in relationship to that 8, and use a 3, it's usually for something in the far ground.
The This is also applicable for digital artists.
Yep, also applicable for digital artists. Mm-hmm. Okay. Awesome. And we all know our buddy, the automatic pencil. I mean, the regular pencil here, the number two pencil. You use that, I use it for layouts. That's all I use it for is layouts, right? And I use it for sketching around, you know, at work when I should be working. then the lead holder, you guys have seen the lead holder? Lead holder is heavy. And that's why I like it. I use it for layout. Sometimes I'll sharpen it up and use it for finishing and stuff too. When I'm doing my stuff traditionally.
Yeah.
Next slide, thanks. Ah, these erasers. People like the erasers, no, it's not. The gum eraser. Gum eraser is used for cleaning your messes. Okay, let's say you do your pencils and whatnot, you want to clean your pencils up before you ink them, use a gum eraser to do that. Okay? Kneaded eraser is used when you're trying to erase directly around your canvas because you can shape it. Okay? Cleans up things pretty nice. That plastic eraser, go over that plastic eraser, tear your paper up. Go over everything with that light. Last. Alright? All the stuff you really want to clean up, last, do that plastic eraser. Joe loves these automatic plastic erasers. He's king of them, so he got me using them now too, right? So these are all
about how you use.
Right. And you can shape stuff with that too. So, and you can use the eraser as a drawing tool. Okay? I've many times took a ruler and drawn my action lines. Unless I got dirty paint. I'm like, I'm gonna use that. I'll use that ruler and draw my action lines out of that dirty paint and leave the dirt down. So again, eraser is a drawing tool too, right? And next slide, please, sir. Inking tool. And you guys ever seen the refillable pintail brush? I love that brush. It's amazing. You know, because again, you know, it gives you a lot of control. What I do with brush pens and stuff like that, I ink all of my organic stuff with brushes. And then I use tech pens for all my background, like all my technical stuff. That way it gives it a nice juxtaposition. Right? So you got the brush pens there. The Bimoji makes a brush pen too, but you can't refill it like that Pentax. Paintbrush. When you can actually paint with a brush, just like I said before. And people, they got different sizes. This is what they call a double off, because it's real small. What you also can do is these two tools I skip. White gel pen and also a brush. You can use with a brush, there's something called OPEC white. You guys ever seen OPEC white? You can use that to do make corrections and stuff, right? You can also use white out and stuff like that, but it's kind of, you know, wasn't that.
Brushes require a lot of control, so you're going to want to practice with it.
I mean, I do my character with the brush here too, don't I?
But how long have you been doing that for?
Oh, here. No doubt.
Exactly.
Sharpie. Okay? Sharpie. Hey, buddy. Fill in the background, they're the best. Get the biggest one you can if you got a black background, right? And then the white gel pen. Now, hit the next slide. I think I might have. There you go. The nib pen. I'm looking for something right here, right? That's the OPEC white I was talking about too. The white out whatever too, right? So the nib pen, you better be look. You can practice with that nib pen. You better be good with that nib pen, buddy. Because if you mess that up, you'll be going through the process of white inkwell a lot. Okay? And this is all traditional tool. You don't have to use it. I know you guys got digital tools, right? So next page, please, sir. And then here is usually the ink. Last of the physical tools. The Strathmore Bristol. Usually, that's from Western stuff. The leader paper is from Japan. It's usually for manga. It's ruled different. Okay? I usually, well, again, right now we got for our manga Origami Super Punch, we're printing the Origami Super Punch Western size, but we are going to shrink everything down to manga size when we get ready to put together the actual collection, okay? Because each comic of Origami Super Punch, when we get to page 70, we're going to collect it. All right, so that's going to be regular manga size. All right, so this is for Shining Top, Urban Guy. So, all right, go ahead and hit the next one. I'm not boring you guys, am I? Okay,
yeah.
Alright. Cheating tools, yes! The tools of cheating, tracing paper. You can use it, they ain't gonna kill you. cheating?
Great. What they say?
You should cheat. That's what they say.
No, that's what they say, dude. It'll come to me soon, right?
Okay. Good people create great artists. Steal.
There you go. That's it. Thank you, Jack. I appreciate it.
Disclaimer, we are not, Imagineless Workshop is not specifically telling you to cheat and steal.
I am.
So, paperwork, you know, this is 11 by 17. This stuff, you can get it anywhere, you know, go. And the thing with tracing paper is that, you know, if you're doing traditional stuff, you can light box, you know, over it and get your stuff down just to practice. Hit the next slide, sir. Ah! You guys know this. Pencil sharpener. You've seen it many times before. It's metal. I love it. This is the pencil sharpener for a lead holder. The lead goes in and you kind of shake it around and get the pencil stuff right.
Definitely do not try to use a traditional sharpener with a lead holder.
Yeah, it ain't gonna work. Then you got your my automatic Exacto electrical, you know. So, all right, next slide.
This feels like a flex, Steve.
What? Hey, man, this is what it is. The physical tools, again, your ruler. I use steel rule. See, guys, ever seen that helix T-square square right there? You know, to make sure I don't mess up the inks, I put pens on it. I glue pens up on it. That way it has ink in it. Do the same thing with my templates. You got the compass. You guys ever seen this tool right here? It is a French curve, but you can shape it. French curves are good when you're going around those extra edges with the pencil. You want those edges to be perfect. That's what French curves. All right? But again, we all got different tools. So, all right, next slide, please. Thank you. Then there's the light box. And you guys know the light box? Again, you got different tools. You don't need it. But if you do stuff by hand, light boxes are great because, you know, light shines through the tracer, right? Next slide. The digital tools come in multiple forms. Drawing tablets are common. They allow you to draw on their flat surface, which transfer directly to the screen. Pen tablet monitors let you draw directly to the screen. This was my old UG. I got a new one now. It's not UG. I got HP. Right? But the UG, I do a whole bunch of stuff with UG. Okay? So you guys got a pen tablet. And you guys got a pen tablet on? Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Because you use it for other stuff, too. Yep.
Is the one in that picture, is that the one that Che uses?
Yeah, that's Che, no.
Okay. What size is that for context?
That is 19 inches, my 1.22.
So, yeah, they do come in that size. Just know what you're looking for. All
right, so go ahead and hit the next one. You guys know the tablets. The old iPads and stuff like that. The iPad is beautiful. Don't get a small one, though. Because you'll be like this.
Sense.
Okay, look, I do it for sketching the small one. I'm small one. Actually, I'm shooting this video with it right there. Look, I sketch on it, that's it. I don't, you know, I don't really do a lot of work on there, but again, they're great. I'm all for them. You know what I mean? Hit the next one. Manga Panel, you gotta use it. It's free. It's kind of like a free clip studio, but it's not free. Mm-hmm. Right? Sketch for Pro, you guys ever use it? All you guys use what? What is it?
I use Photoshop.
And then what else? There's another one.
Procreate.
Procreate. Everybody uses Procreate. All right. In Clip Studio, I'm a big clip. This is funny. I'm going to tell you guys a funny piece. Joe will tell you. I've been using Clip Studio for 20 years. But it was called Manga Studio then, and no one would listen to it.
I remember that.
Well, it's Manga. You think Manga sucks? All right. Okay.
Forgot about Critta.
You get away from me.
You know, well, Fifth will really have
a Critta. We got a studio mate who lives in Malaysia named Fifth. We say he uses liquid Critta. All right? He got this green bottle he's always drinking. I said, what's that liquid Critta behind you, dude?
Now, Clip Studio is also good for lettering.
Oh, yeah.
That's what about GIMP? You know,
you get away from me. Oh, yeah, this guy uses GIMP. I don't know what planet he's from.
So was the first part of this drawing thing how to draw in the apocalypse?
He still uses scribes over the guy. We're ancient. But hey, whatever you use, whatever works. That's what it comes down to. Right?
Use whatever you feel like is going to help you in your pursuit. These are just some recommended tools that some a lot of us use. Use whatever
No, go back.
Directions.
Oh, shit. keep going, one more. There you go.
Oh, here.
Right.
Okay.
All right, so this is our contact info. Nope, go over.
Sorry.
There you go.
That was the slide he was on the whole time.
No, he wasn't.
He was on that one.
Go past one. Go back one.
Back one?
Yeah, there you go.
Okay.
So this is our contact information.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's me. That ain't you.
I'm sorry.
All right, this is our contact information, guys. You know, this is our fan page. Actually, no. This Detroit Train Craft, we belong to a larger group called Detroit Train Craft, right? So again, like I told you before, we're trying to build this community back up. Detroit Train Craft, they do a lot of comics and stuff too. You know, we just like the manga army, the comic army, those guys, right? So, again, that's why I put the QR codes on here, take the pictures, you know, do what you guys need to. Stay in touch with us. All right, please stay in touch with us. We're trying to build this community back up. Okay, if you guys got any questions about anything, nothing's crazy, nothing's stupid. You guys get in touch with us, and we'll try to answer them to the best of our ability. So, also, I'm going to be doing some free classes. I do them every year. So I'll be doing some free classes, writing and drawing classes, you know, to help you guys if you need it, you know, to try to get on pace. I mean, nothing, don't worry about bothering me, because people are like, oh, I want to bother you. Don't worry about it. Get in touch with me. I got my card up here. We got some other swag up here. You got to take this stuff. And I'm going to be doing portfolio reviews, if you guys got them, after we finish this. One more slide, please. So, you guys okay with this? You guys got the pictures or?
Shining Spotlight, where we interview guests in the industry in order to inspire everybody. So this is, we interview like people in the manga industry, but we've interviewed guests in, you know, other parts of, I'm just gonna say the comic space, or, you know, we interview like, you know, some voice actors too, but mainly it's more focused on comics. So, you know, we've even had people, you know, even from like, you know, actually, you know, from Japan talk about manga from their perspective, and it's all creatively based. We're on YouTube, and I don't think the link is technically correct up there, but
it may not be, but it's the QR code.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, that's me. My fault. QR code is good. That works on the crack. QR code is good.
But you should be able to search up Shining Spotlight on YouTube, and you should be able to find them pretty easily. Oh, and that'll work. Shining Spotlight or Shining Otaku.
And I definitely recommend it, because there's a wealth of knowledge on there. I'm not just saying it because it's me. We've had people on, you know, who've done like title animation, have done stuff for like WandaVision. We've had people on who have had, you know, we've had the voice of Naruto on, people who are interested in voice acting. We've had
OEL guys.
We've had the creator of Tribe, which is like a 90s comic, but it's like the best-selling, you know, indie black comic of all time, like worldwide. So there's so much knowledge on there, so I definitely recommend it. You don't even have to listen to us talk, you can listen to those guys talk, and they've been doing it forever, so.
All right, now we got the Honeycomb Hideout. Talk about the Honeycomb Hideout, Joe.
Well, the Honeycomb Hideout is, as I like to refer to it, a ponderous podcast for pop culture people. We talk about upcoming events, we do movie reviews, we talk about a lot of creatively oriented topics. Like, for instance, we talk a lot about the writer's strike recently. That we do deep dives into content, and it's a cultural influence. Like, we actually just did an episode on Junji Ito in regards to, you know, that was our Halloween episode. And, but
that
we just...
Right there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We went ahead and mentioned it for that. Yeah. But, the goal is to create a conversation. Myself and my co-host, Christine, will sometimes have someone on to, you know, provide an additional context, but the goal is to generate conversation about sometimes, you know, shit maybe you don't even think about in regards to pop culture and its influences and how it can influence you or how you can influence it. So, yeah, we talk about all kinds of stuff. We're on Spotify, we're on Apple Podcasts, we're all over the place.
That's your Spotify QR.
Okay, this? Okay, good. But we also posted...
QR code is bad. This is actually QR code is right, too.
Okay. Now, those...
that's the right QR.
Now, the... I do also post them on the Imagine Sports Shop website. So that's a quick and easy way to reach it there. but we are on Spotify as well. So yeah, feel free to check us out, post a comment, send us questions. We're more than willing to, if we get questions, we will answer them on the show.
Again, like I said, we're trying to build community. We want to hear from each one of you guys. We want to know what you're working on. You know, and if you guys got any questions on what you're working on, I'm pretty sure we'll be able to answer.
Right, we want to build like a supportive community. That being said, boo your earlier alliteration, boo. But yes, we want to be supportive.
I'm old school.
All right, so we're going to be doing the portfolio review. We're going to set up for that. Please take swag and stuff.
Oh, look, we do have
one more raffle. Yeah, I'm ready to go. One more raffle.
One more raffles.
Okay.
Well, hey, Nick, do you want to come up here and draw some?
You guys got two raffles. I'm going to pull the dice.
Two and then pull the dice?
Yes.
Two and then.
Okay, now these first raffles are for the artist. Oh, yeah, for the art and writing documentation libraries.
If it ain't in there, it don't exist.
I like how Irvin held that up as a sort of like angelic music.
Yep.
419-8791.
Uh-oh. Oh,
all
right. You got the bugger mode.
Feel free to send us
an
email.
And if you guys got any questions also about any of the stuff, you know the guy is working on. You know, to be honest, she's hot on the heels of her next 10 pages of
Project
Nirvana. So, you know, if anything about, you know, the process, she's going through all that, you know. The same thing with Earth.
Okay.
I basically became part of this group from asking a lot of questions. So, ask questions, go.
Right. We got it.
Yeah. It's also, but the goal is basically to help each other tell the best stories we can. Right. That's really the entire point of Imaginalist Workshop.
Right.
I think they said earlier, if it's a hobby, then, you know, it'll be a hobby. But if you're passionate about it, you probably will be end up here at Youmacon presenting your stuff. I mean,
yep, we have students that actually have, had questions for us that have gone on to do their own projects. One of them actually does animation for which studio?
One of them, he does animation for Microsoft right now.
Yeah.
He works for Microsoft.
Yeah. So, like, honestly, we don't have to be an endpoint, but we can help you get to where you're trying to go.
Because we're also screenwriters, so a lot of the stuff that we come up with is based on screenwriting. You know what I mean? So, at the end of the day, you know, we don't just teach just comics or whatever. We take it to other levels and other places. That's why we want you guys to keep in touch.
Okay, for the last raffle, for the Wacom tablet.
We got an honest question to ask.
Oh, no.
Who don't have a tablet or who don't have an iPad or anything like that?
Who has nothing?
Who has nothing?
No means of digital artwork whatsoever.
So count them all. One. You're one. You're two. You're three.
Hands up, please.
You're four. You're five.
Remember your number. Buddy.
You're six. Hold on. Did I miss something?
Yeah, everyone keep your hands up.
Keep your hands high. All
right. Hands high, please.
Hands high. All right.
Okay, so let's start over.
You're one.
Remember your number.
Yeah.
You're two. You're three. You're four. Five, you're six, and you're seven. What's your number?
Five.
Okay,
cool. Right here.
Okay, what about?
You'll be eight.
You're eight.
Okay, so
what about her back here?
You're six.
Nine.
You're six?
You're six.
Okay.
Eight. Okay, so
it's going to be 10. Yes,
well,
y'all got him, right?
Yeah, you got one.
I thought he was number one.
Yeah.
Oh, all
right.
Okay.
So we got 10. I'm not to complicate this like this.
Roll is good, too. Eight. It's all 10. What are we going to do?
Okay, you can put your hands down now.
Okay.
All right.
You're going to float.
All right, so we're...
Here comes the D10.
Okay. Four. All right. We have... That is a six. odds were in your favor.
Odds were definitely in your favor. This is the highlight.
I always want to say that.
This is the highlight of his day.
What?
Yeah. How dare you?
All right. So I believe that's all the prizes, right?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay.
Well, you can give out. We can. You know, we're gonna give out extra.
Okay, yeah. I've got a bonus prize. And let's see. What's 1, 2, 3 of the extras?
Who doesn't like free comics?
Yeah, right.
Hit the raffle.
Your ticket.
Let's see.
What's the prize?
Okay, I'll do it. All right. Okay. Ticket number 4198788.
Hit him again.
Going once, going twice, going back. All right. So we got 4198794. Oh, yeah. All right. Congratulations. And those are all three physical copies of the series so far.
You're becoming a fan just like the fan club.
Yep. We actually do. The extras does have a fan club.
URLs in the front so you can read online.
As many manga readers do, they will go on and read ahead once the physical is no longer.
Yes.
Oh, no. All right.
One more?
I mean, if you guys have any questions, you can.
Oh, yeah. We're going to open up the Q&A before we start the.
The last go around there.
Yeah. We don't have the tickets, so I can do this. Okay.
We don't like taking him out in public. But yeah, does anybody have any questions? At this point, we're going to move into the portfolio review and